who is going to talk about Hodgkin's lymphoma. Nominations are invited for the post of President, Secretary and various posts from January. The term ends this December. So people who are interested to give their nominations can give it to Secretary or President or Dr. Chandrasekhar. Yes, Dr. Prabhu, please, you are waiting for it.
Really sorry, sir.
No problem, sir. Is the time, I request all the speakers to stick to their timing. The timing allotted is 18 minutes and 2 minutes for questions. Please.
Called Hodgkin's disease or Hodgkin's lymphoma. This talk is sponsored by Roche, so they asked me to put some slides with Roche name on, which I didn't have, so I'm just quickly skipping through these slides. See, nothing better illustrates a particular period, a particular disease than a typical patient. So what I'll start off with is describing a patient that we saw recently and just work through the diagnosis and various challenges this particular patient presents in terms of diagnosis and various management issues. So it's a 27-year-old biophysicist working in a private hospital. He presented with cough, blood stringing of sputum, evening rise of temperature, fatigue and weight loss for the last 6 weeks. So this clinical combination is not typical of lymphoma, it's typical of, it can be also seen in chronic infections. So this is a very common way in which lymphoma is present to us. His hemoglobin was 10.6, he had a raised ESR of 95, total count was 13.2 and platelets was 666 and there was Rolle formation. LFT's renal function test was normal, LDH was 286. So this patient presented to initially the infectious disease consultant and subsequently to me. So this is a very common presentation. This kind of scenario could mean either an infection. All of us know what infection we're talking about. Tuberculosis is a very common infection which presents like this. And tuberculosis continues to be a number one differential diagnosis. Can be a tumor. When you talk about tumor with this kind of presentation, you talk about lymphomas which have this kind of typical weight loss, stretching sweats, and sometimes lymphomas and TBs are, TB is very distinguishable. So this is often, this is a big problem with practicing hematologists and practicing clinicians. Very often we get patients who present with lymphadenopathy and what can be called as B symptoms in the context of lymphoma. And the important aspect of the important role that we have to perform is to ensure that what we are treating is lymphoma. The reason to emphasize this point is very often due to various reasons like resource constraints, etc. some patients get treated as TB and eventually find out when they don't respond that they have lymphoma. So this particular patient, how do we investigate? Obviously the talk is entitled Hodgkin's lymphoma, so this patient eventually had Hodgkin's lymphoma. So the investigation that one should perform in a patient like this is a hemogram, which will include your hemoglobin, white cells, platelets, and ESR, liver kidney function test, LDH. The subsequent tests like echo, PFT, PET CT, and bone marrow biopsy is after you've kind of thought of Hodgkin's disease and the biopsy has confirmed Hodgkin's disease. The reason for including cardiac echo and PFT is because patients will eventually need chemotherapy, which is likely to affect their heart and lung function. PET CT scan will come to that. All patients with Hodgkin's lymphoma need imaging to establish the stage of disease. In Hodgkin's, PET CT at the diagnostic stage and subsequent evaluation is well established. Therefore, PET CT is desirable in these patients. And bone marrow biopsy, again, is a controversial area in patients with Hodgkin's disease. If PET CT is negative, many people think there is no role. PET CT doesn't show any increased bony, if the PET CT doesn't show any enhancement in the bone, there is no role for a bone marrow biopsy. At least that is what majority of doctors treating Hodgkin's lymphoma believe. So Hodgkin's lymphoma has a bimodal age distribution. As we know, it is very common in the young adult or early adolescent age group, and there's a second peak in the elderly. So there are two peaks, and they present the initial peak. In young adults, they tend to do extremely well, and as one can expect, the older adults don't tend to do well with Hodgkin's disease. So there is a bimodal peak in Hodgkin's lymphoma. So why is Hodgkin's lymphoma important? It is one of those hematological malignancies which has excellent prognosis. And if you look at a patient with fairly a standard Hodgkin's lymphoma today, you would expect 80% of such patients to have almost a normal lifespan. So why this improvement in Hodgkin lymphoma survival? It is mainly because of initially it was because of radiotherapy that there was a decrease in mortality, not very impressive, but subsequently with combination chemotherapy, patients achieved excellent response. And this reduction in mortality is continued. Especially in today's day and age, we've got various newer molecules, like you have rituximab in non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, you've got certain monoclonal antibodies in Hodgkin's disease, and certain immunomodulators. So Hodgkin's disease already is a disease with excellent prognosis. The prognosis is getting better even in a very difficult subset of patients like relapsed refractory Hodgkin's disease. So this slide is just to tell you that this is an old slide, but just tells you that Hodgkin's disease is curable, because if you see from the time of diagnosis, 40, 45, 50 years from diagnosis, this is an old slide, so it says around 65% of patients are alive. So if you kind of make a similar slide from, let's say, between 1990 to 2017, this will be probably higher. So most patients with Hodgkin's lymphoma get cured. So it presents some additional challenges in managing this disease. So epidemiology, Hodgkin's disease has certain unique epidemiological features. There are certain families where you tend to see many Hodgkin's disease. They're not very sure if it's genetic or environmental, but there's a lot of focus on environmental features, environmental issues in incidence of Hodgkin's disease. Infection plays an important part in etiopathogenesis of Hodgkin's disease, and the important infection to consider is EBV. Epstein-Barr virus is important. Etiological factor in patients with Hodgkin's disease. This has been shown in various histopathological studies where they can see EBV nuclear antigen in the biopsy specimen. So basically what it means is some patients with EBV do not have the immunological capacity to get rid of that infection, and that chronic infection can result in Hodgkin's disease. There are other viruses you can see it in immunosuppression, like in HIV, like in post-transplant, sometimes you can get Hodgkin's disease. Hodgkin's disease, socioeconomic status and Hodgkin's disease is an interesting association. It is seen across the socioeconomic spectrum, but what is seen is in the developing countries, in the lower socioeconomic spectrum, you tend to see more aggressive lymphocyte depleted variety of Hodgkin's disease, whereas in the more Western affluent society, you tend to see nodular sclerosis variety of Hodgkin's disease. So clinical features, I'm sure all of us know how Hodgkin's disease present. Very often, the good risk patient usually present to you with a few lymph nodes in the neck or armpits, which doesn't go away, sometimes no symptoms at all. They may have very minor symptoms. Usually of the lymph node enlargement is of a duration of 2 to 3 months. So that is early Hodgkin's disease presentation. Sometimes patient may present to you with advanced Hodgkin's disease with plenty of generalized lymphadenopathy, hepatosplenomegaly, anemia, severe B symptoms like trenching, sweats, weight loss, etc. But there's nothing that is, there is no symptom that tells you that this is Hodgkin's and not tuberculosis. So often TB and Hodgkin's is a big mimic, and it can mimic tuberculosis also. There are certain things that we all know very well. Hodgkin's lymphoma tends to spread contiguously, so it doesn't jump lymph node area, but that's only it's a general rule in some patients, but many patients, if you have other associated immunosuppression, etc., it can be, so discrete areas can be involved. Alcohol-induced pain in lymph node is often taught, but very rarely seen. Pruritus and B symptom is common. So there's nothing specific about symptoms in Hodgkin's disease. So in terms of nodes that are involved, if you see frequency of involved nodes, neck nodes are the commonest, and the other nodes like mediastinal parietic nodes follow that. Subsequent, the axillary nodes are less common than the neck nodes. And inguinal nodes, iliac nodes, etc. is increasingly much less common than the neck and axillary and mediastinal nodes. So most of the patients present with nodes in the body above the diaphragm. And extramedial involvement like bone marrow, lungs, bone, etc. is only seen in 1 to 10% of patients. So lymphoma classification always a problem, but in Hodgkin's disease it's pretty straightforward compared to non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. There are only two things that we need to differentiate. Let's just stick to WHO classification. You've got two different types of Hodgkin's lymphoma. The first one is the nodular lymphocyte predominant Hodgkin's lymphoma. It's a completely separate entity. We're not even going to talk about it. Then you've got Hodgkin's lymphoma, which I'm sure from your pathology days you remember, is four types. One is the nodular sclerosing, which is a very common, is the commonest type of Hodgkin's lymphoma. Then you've got lymphocyte-rich mixed cellularities and lymphocyte-depleted classical Hodgkin's lymphoma. So the most important histopathological distinction to make is to separate this entity out, because it's got unique characters, which we won't go into. But these are the histological types of Hodgkin's disease. In today's day and age, where we've got excellent combination chemotherapy, the initial classification, initial prognostic significance attached to this pathological classification doesn't hold anymore. So this is a classical slide of Hodgkin's disease, and this is that often described Reed-Sternberg cells, you know, alveoli, nucleus, etc. So what is interesting in Hodgkin's disease is that, see, this is a tumor cell, but the bulk of the lymph node is filled by inflammatory infiltrate. So if you look at a Hodgkin's disease slide, the tumor cells only occupy less than 1% of the slide. So that is a very unique feature of Hodgkin's disease. In the interest of time, I won't go through as to why. But that's unlike in non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, you would expect patients to have sheets of lymphoma cells. Whereas here in Hodgkin's disease, the tumor cells are very scanty, and most of the cells that you see is all inflammatory cells. So this is a typical Reed-Sternberg cell, you know, with bilobed nucleus, very prominent nucleoli, okay, giving the alveoli appearance to the nuclei. So this is a classical slide of Hodgkin's Reed-Sternberg cells. And this is a common variety of Hodgkin's disease, which shows the nodular sclerosing variety, which is a very common type of Hodgkin's disease, where you get dense fibrosis separating the lymph node into nodules. So, as I was just mentioning, lymphocyte predominant nodular Hodgkin disease is a separate disease. So you got this type of lymphocyte rich nodular sclerosis, mixed cellularity and lymphocyte depletion. So these cells are CD15 and CD30 positive, which is an important immunohistochemistry marker, which has to be done in all specimens with Hodgkin disease. So in the interest of time, we'll just quickly run through this slide. As I told you, there's a separate entity. Classical Hodgkin lymphoma is CD15 and CD30 positive. Nodular lymphocyte predominant Hodgkin lymphoma is CD15, CD30 negative, but CD20 positive, which is usually seen in non-Hodgkin lymphoma. But we are going to talk about only this side of the slide. So this is a very busy slide. So let's we know all this from many pathology, medicine, oncology teaching. So Hodgkin's disease is staging is important because these two patients here represent early stage disease, well, this is advanced stage disease. So early stage disease is stage 1 and stage 2. Stage 1 is single lymph node involved lymph node region or a single extralymphatic site. Stage 2 is tumor site, but in the same side of the diaphragm. Stage 3 is involvement both above and below the diaphragm. And stage 4 is diffuse involvement with plenty of extralymphatic tissue like the bone marrow, like the liver, etc. So stage 4 being the worst. So this is an important assessment to make when you diagnose patients with Hodgkin's disease. So are there any other prognosticators other than staging in Hodgkin's disease? Yes, there are. There are 7 important laboratory parameters and epidemiological parameters which tell us whether a patient is going to do well or not. Serum albumin less than 4, hemoglobin less than 10.5, male gender, age more than 45 years, stage 4 disease, white cell count more than 15,000, and absolute lymphocyte count less than 600. So obviously none of these risk factors, if you look at score 0, 98% have 5-year overall survival, so this is remarkable. As the number of risk factors increase, it goes to 67%. Still, if compared to all other hematological malignancy, Hodgkin's disease, even in advanced stages, tend to do well. So this is an important slide because when you treat Hodgkin's disease, there are two or three important distinctions that you have to make. You have to see whether the patient has got early disease or advanced disease, and the early disease you have to separate them out as early disease without risk factor and early disease with risk factor. So when you say early disease with risk factor, you're looking at patients who have stage 1 or 2 disease but have big bulky lymphadenopathy like large mesocell lymphadenopathy, or even within the stage 2 if they have 4 or more lymph node regions within the chest and abdomen, more the lymph node region, higher the age, and have a combination of B symptoms, ESR, etc., will put early disease like stage 1 and 2 disease with these features, they will be seen as stage 1 and 2 disease with high risk features. So that's an important distinction to make. So Hodgkin's disease can be divided into early stage Hodgkin's disease and advanced stage. Early stage is stage 1 and 2, and advanced stage is stage 3 and 4. So let's say our patient that we had, in spite of all the symptoms, just had some mediastinal nodes and left-sided cervical nodes. It eventually turned out to be nodular sclerosing Hodgkin's disease, and he had these symptoms, so stage 2B. So, and also his ESR was high, and the lymph node mass in the mediastinal was bulky. So it'd be considered early stage Hodgkin's disease with high risk features. So when you see patients with stage 1 or 2 Hodgkin's disease, the important questions that you have to ask is whether they have favorable or unfavorable features. Our patient had unfavorable features. And in Hodgkin's disease, the initial treatment historically was radiotherapy, and subsequently chemotherapy was added to it. So a burning question in early stage Hodgkin's disease, many patients do well. The question is whether you should have combined radiotherapy with chemo or chemo alone. So this is a question that investigators have asked, and I think there is an answer which I'll just go through, but how we got through to that answer, there are a lot of historical studies which looked at patients who had radiotherapy with chemotherapy and chemotherapy alone. If you look at them, all of them did well, but the summary is that patients who have in early stage Hodgkin's disease, if you have chemotherapy followed by consolidated radiotherapy, your risk of relapse from Hodgkin disease is very low, but that benefit is offset by radiotherapy-related side effects. So we talked about this in the earlier slide, you know, high risk features. So just for the argument's sake, our patient, let's say, had all these high risk features. So he's got stage 2 disease with high risk features. So how would we treat it? Will chemo alone be sufficient, or do you have to use chemotherapy and radiotherapy? So what is the evidence for that? So the reason why we're talking about whether chemo will be sufficient or chemo radiotherapy is because earlier in the 70s, radiotherapy was not such an exact science. They used total lymphoid radiotherapy. With all these things, you tend to have higher incidence of second malignancies and cardiovascular mortality and morbidity. But if you look at 2008 onwards, you have very focused delivery of radiotherapy. So because we got better at radiotherapy, this question has resurfaced. If somebody has got limited stage Hodgkin's disease, should he be treated after chemotherapy with radiotherapy as well? So, early stage 1 or 2 Hodgkin's disease, if you have favorable disease factors, then you can, the standard treatment as of now based on meta-analysis is ABVD followed by involved field radiotherapy. But let's say the young woman, you have to the radiotherapy team will involve the breast, etc. Then you can avoid radiotherapy and you can just use ABVD alone. Early unfavorable, again, no cycles of chemotherapy, and radiotherapy is an essential part of treatment. Same logic, if the patient refuses radiotherapy or the risk of radiotherapy is considered high, then treatment with 4-6 ABVD. So I'll just skip all these slides. So, can you decide, is there any tool that is available to you to decide whether a patient needs radiotherapy or not? PET CT is being used increasingly in Hodgkin's disease. What is well known is in Hodgkin's disease, PET CT after second course of treatment, if it shows CR, then it separates out a group of patients who are going to do extremely well, and if it doesn't show CR, it separates out a patient who are not going to do well, and you have to do different things. So in early stage disease, if your PET CT is positive after your second course of treatment, that might guide you towards adding radiotherapy. So this is just a summary, but what you have to remember is that we are talking about early stage Hodgkin's disease where overall survival is anyway with or without radiotherapy. But if there is a particular direction in which you can guide your patient, you have to use radiotherapy unless it's contraindicated. So in terms of, because we don't have much time, I'll just quickly go through the rest of the slides. So advanced stage Hodgkin's lymphoma is stage 3 and 4. So in this questions mainly is, we know ABVD, which has been there for ages. Is there anything better than ABVD? As of now, ABVD is the standard for Hodgkin's disease treatment. And although there are other combination chemotherapy, ABVD is worse better in most situations. Again, we use PET CT in advanced stage lymphoma. Some authors say that your PET CT after two courses of chemotherapy is still positive if you escalate your treatment to BCOM. Other than ABVD, you tend to do well. Again, radiation, role of radiation in advanced stage Hodgkin's is usually limited to residual disease. Again, that can be guided by PET CT scan. Hodgkin's disease is one disease where the PET CT scan does play a huge part in prognosticating and deciding treatment and risk stratification. So this is a slide which shows, you know, complete resolution after PET. This is what we're looking for after starting treatment, after the second course of ABVD. So that's a metabolic CR on the right side. So patients do relapse, and when they relapse, you have transplant as an option after you salvage chemotherapy. And what is interesting is monoclonal antibodies were used predominantly in non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, but there are newer immunotherapy being used in Hodgkin's lymphoma, which I'm sure we'll hear about increasingly in the next few years. One is brentuximab vedotin, which is anti-CD30 antibody. Then in solid tissue malignancy, you've got something called PD-1 blockade, which is again being used in patients with Hodgkin's disease. So, last sentence, because this is such a curable malignancy, many patients achieve great response and live for a long period of time. It's really important to recognize long-term complications. Patients with Hodgkin's disease, once they've crossed the first few hurdles, die of second malignancies and die of cardiovascular disease. So you're monitoring, it's a lifelong commitment to treat patients with Hodgkin's disease. You need to monitor them for second malignancies and cardiovascular disease.
you joined over the certificate. If there's any question, you can ask him one or two questions.